G'day, and welcome to this week's episode of The Shtick. I'm Barry.
I'm Eva.
G'day, it's still Adam.
And I'm Frank.
Frank Penhaljarek, our special guest for today, our special panellist. And the reason he's here is because he wouldn't let us film in his establishment without him being present.
Welcome, Frank.
G'day.
Thank you, Eva.
Why are we here? Because we love hardware.
We certainly do.
We are hardware.
we're here because it's Sukkot.
Is it showing?
And also to talk about Jewish handymen.
Exactly, because at this
if
time...
If there's such a thing.
As a Jewish handyman?
Yeah, that's what we're discussing. Okay? But we see we've got examples here of what appears to be either an escapee... No?
It's handyman, it's handyman fashion for the summer season. This okay. is what
now
people
you're
are
wearing this so that you can be seen very clearly.
Correct.
So you don't get in anyone's way.
Yes.
I have my real tool here, which is called a grater. Barry, you have... I have a plunger I have a plunger just in case something backs up in the middle of the show. And you've got your hammer.
Yes.
What else have you got in your toolkit?
I have lots of things because I've got this is I am actually a handyman.
Okay.
I'm one of the unusual breed of.
But if I was to say to you, go and fix up the screw.
We've talked about this before.
You have your own.
We come from a history and a tradition. Both you and I, and in fact, a lot of Jewish people come from that tradition. We all grew up with what we would call the classic Jewish toolbox. And
here is
what I would say is the classic Jewish toolbox is, first of all, the most important tool is the butter knife.
Screwdriver.
The screwdriver. Yes. This is a small screwdriver. Yeah. I also have, this is quite unusual. Sometimes you wouldn't have two screwdrivers.
This is like the butter knife of the Phillips different sizes.
Exactly
correct?
Right. If you need some heavy cutting, you can always go for the serrated bread knife. That can get through plywood for sure, some masonite, but
generally challah.
It's pretty damn good.
Methinks you're perpetuating the stereotype. I'm going to ask Frank, are you familiar with this stereotype that Jews cannot be handy people?
This is why I'm going bankrupt. They don't buy anything in the place. You see, if you've got a double-edged saw here, look at this.
Yeah.
This is for the fine stuff and this is for the coarse stuff.
So you're saying that out of all the things in this vast space, you can't beat that particular double serrated.
We can beat it easily and comfortably, but not to the Jewish population.
Okay, you can't convince them.
They don't like doing it themselves.
Okay.
So it's, you know, they come in, they wander around, they look around, and they get befuddled by everything they see, and or they go and ask somebody who's obviously not Jewish, tell me, what does this do?
Barry, I'm thinking of offering you a job so you can explain it to them. Do you speak Yiddish well?
I can speak Yiddish well.
Good. We're going to get more of this after we hear what the rabbi has to say.
Oh. Okay.
We are talking about Jewish handymen and the tasks that handymen do. Now, as a rabbi, I not only have a responsibility for the spiritual needs of my congregation, but I also have a responsibility for the physical needs of my congregation. That is why I run a class down here at Penhaljarek's hardware store for the religious Jewish people to help them in the making of things. We put together things, and I am, as a master, happer and clapper, because happing and clapping is the collective name that we use for a Jewish tradesperson or for a tradesperson non-specific. Happing and clapping, hitting and knocking, putting things together. And I have been very successful in teaching a generation of Jewish men how to fix things and how to put things together. And to all of those who've come to my class, now resting in hospital, recovering from injuries, I wish you a happy new year, well over the fast, and enjoy your time in the sukkah if you get out of hospital in time. Have a wonderful week.
Now, Frank, I wanted to ask you, I've seen a lot, actually, of Jewish people wandering around here. Today's Sunday, so it's a good day for them to be shopping. What's a tool that they will, a lot of them will buy to use? Is there a common one that they buy to use? Is there one? Is there many? Have you observed?
There are two very common ones, Eva. The first is a ball of string, and the second is super glue.
Is that to hang themselves when they can't do the handyman? What is that
for? I don't ask what they're using it for. That would be like when you're in prison, you don't ask, what are you in here for?
You don't ask those questions.
Well, there are a lot of rituals that involve string and super
very multi-purpose.
We can't divulge. Well, that just to the question you're asking about too. Yeah. Do you have any tools? Is there a favourite tool? What's the tool you use the most?
Well, it depends what I'm doing. It's like asking what the favourite tool is. If a plumber comes in, there'll be plumbing tools. If an electrician comes in versus a painter versus someone who's doing something else, there are specific tools. So, yes, you might have a hammer, but what was what we said before? If the only tool you had was a hammer, everything then would become a nail.
What about liquid nails? That's a new thing.
You can knock a screw in with a hammer, believe me.
Yes. Yeah.
Well, we grew up, you know, you'd find out, as we were talking about the Jewish toolbox, and you had the the screwdriver, which was a bread knife, and bits and pieces. And I used to use a rasp as a vegetable rasp.
It's a grater with many sides
for finishing off timber. But that was me. Mm. But the fact is, I think every Jewish household has at least one tool which was probably left by some other tradesman. I call them leftover tools.
Yes.
And it might be a tzvang.
Oh, that's so beautiful.
A pair of pliers.
Yes.
A pair of pliers
are great.
Not only could you grip things with it, it was also a hammer. You could bash
or for shaking
it
while you're yelling at someone. You need it.
Or threatening.
Like that. Threatening.
Yeah. Absolutely. My favourite tool, because I am a handyman, is actually a really very sophisticated piece of a little power electric screwdriver.
Nice.
It's really very good. But
nice.
You pretend you know how to use it.
Most people would at least have a tape measure. A lot of Jews that I know, a lot of people that I know, have at their fingertips every tool that they require.
Mm.
Hello?
Yeah, and a phone number. That's all you need.
I'm nicking our plumber.
No, I need to dispel that myth in front of everyone, including Frank, that Jews are good with tools and being handy people.
I agree with that.
You know, for years, myself, my friends have been fixing things, whether it be lights or a stain on the carpet or some crumbs on the table. We've been fixing it and doing it properly. We haven't called anyone.
You're talented.
Is that because your parents weren't handy?
No, my parents' background, they're both people of science.
Did they do things in the
rumpus room?
He made me the workbench so I could do stuff. And then we painted the house and then I burnt it down and then we had to rebuild it.
Your children
are like they are because of their parents.
Because you weren't in the garage hacking and banging and, you know.
You were in somebody else's garage banging.
When my son, God bless him, because no one else will, when Ari was a little kid and he was asked, what do you want to be when you grow up? He says, I want to be like my dad. I want to be a fixer. Because they grew up with the understanding that if anything was broken, anything needed to be done, dad would fix it.
But that's when you're working in accounting.
But not his dad. That's right.
Oh, I'm embarrassed.
Yeah.
With when your hard hat.
And you don't even know my son.
Yeah. No, but there was one time my washing machine broke. And I found out they would cost $70 to get someone out to just have a look at it. I went online, I found the schematics, I rang, I found the part, it was a bit of a drive, a $17 part. I came home, took it apart, did the whole thing myself. I videoed it, I put it online, and everyone's comments was, you're Jewish, you shouldn't be doing this. And I found that remarkable. There is a stereotype there that shouldn't be there.
No, but that's very heartening because your generations are becoming a bit more savvy.
Yeah.
We have a lot of Jewish people actually who are quite good around the house and handymen.
Yes.
It's amazing. They'll always have a go. Not all of them, but many will have a go.
Yeah.
And what we try and do is explain to them how to do it.
Yeah.
We try to encourage them to have a go.
Yes, because they buy tools that way. This guy only buys a knife.
No, it's from 1942. He never bought it.
I inherited that.
Yeah.
Well, look, it's been fascinating. I think we're going to have to continue more of this and more about you, Frank, and about your business and about your history, which is very interesting and fascinating. After the break.
Oh, hi.
Hello, I'm Mordechai Tulbeg, a handyman.
Oh, good. I've been waiting for you. So I have some stuff
you need your accounts fixing.
No. I have something that I need.
Your tax return needs a little repairing?
No, I have some stuff that I need
your wedding ring needs a little renovation.
Listen, I don't know what you're talking about, but I have some plumbing that needs fixing. I have a garage door that needs repairing, and my kitchen needs a renovation. Are you going to be able to help with any of that?
What kind of handyman do you think I am? I handle paper, not labor. Good Shabbos.
Oh, that's really helpful.